Hello everybody, welcome to Rao's analysis of the Union Budget. In the first video of our budget analysis, we have discussed upon the three dominant themes of the Union Budget, that is the aspirational India, economic development and caring society. In our second video, that is in this particular video, we shall focus upon a clean and sound financial sector, the corruption-free policy-driven good governance, the various proposals related to taxation, the trends in macroeconomic indicators, and lastly, we shall discuss about the various positives and negatives about the Union Budget. Let us start our video analysis with respect to a clean and sound financial sector. Now, coming to various initiatives in the financial sector, now when you as a depositor deposit your money with the banks, the deposits are insured by an agency which is referred to as the Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation, which is a subsidiary of RBI. Now, in order to avail the insurance, the depositors are not required to pay the premium. Rather, the premium on the insurance is actually paid by the banks. Apart from that, the maximum amount of money which the depositor is liable to get from the banks in the events of the collapse of the banks is rupees 1 lakh. Now, recently, there was a crisis in the Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank, because of which there was a growing clamor to increase the deposit insurance coverage. Accordingly, in this year's Union Budget, the Finance Minister has decided to increase the deposit insurance coverage to rupees 5 lakh. Now, this is a very important initiative taken by the Government of India, and hence it becomes important from your prelims perspective. From your prelims perspective, please note that the deposit insurance is provided by the Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation. The premium on the deposits is not paid by the depositors, rather the premium is paid by the banks. The maximum amount of the deposit insurance coverage is rupees 5 lakh and the deposit insurance coverage extends to the scheduled commercial banks, the cooperative banks, as well as the regional rural banks. And please note that presently the NBFC sector is not covered under the deposit insurance coverage of the Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation. The next set of initiatives are related to deepening of the bond market. Let us understand as to what do you mean by deepening of the bond market and how it would benefit the Indian economy. Now, the corporate entities across the world issue the bonds in order to raise the long-term loans. Hence, a well-developed bond market enables the corporate entities to meet their investment needs. It reduces the pressure on the banks because the corporate entities are able to raise the long-term loans from the capital market rather than being dependent upon the banks. Thirdly, it reduces the pressure on the government for investment since the corporates are able to raise long-term loans from the bond market. And through these loans, they are able to undertake greater amount of investment. So, if you look at the bond market in case of developed economies, in developed economies, the bond market is well developed. However, in case of India, even today, the bond market is underdeveloped. So, this underdeveloped bond market has in turn caused a number of problems in the Indian economy. For instance, since the bond market has remained underdeveloped, the corporate entities usually borrow loans from banks and NBFCs as well as through the external commercial borrowings. Now, when the corporate entities borrow loans from NBFCs and the banks as such use their short-term deposits to give the long-term loans. So, this problem leads to the asset liability mismatch for the banks and NBFCs. Apart from that, if you look at the gestational period, that is the time to complete the infrastructure projects, the gestational period is quite higher and this in turn leads to the increase in the non-performing assets of the Indian banks. Further, in case the corporate entities borrow loans from other countries to the external commercial borrowings, this in turn exposes them to the exchange rate fluctuations. So, the underdeveloped bond market in case of India has caused a number of problems in the Indian economy, wherein the corporate entities are not able to meet their investment needs from the capital market. They are mainly dependent upon the banks and NBFCs to raise the long-term loans and this has also increased the pressure on the government for undertaking the investment. So the government of India has announced a number of measures so as to strengthen the bond market in this year's budget. The first measure is that certain specified categories of government securities would now be fully open for the non-resident investors. Now presently, the non-resident investors are allowed to invest in the government securities without any kind of limit. However, whatever profits the non-resident investors earn on the government securities, they are not allowed to be repatriated back to their countries. That is, whatever profits they earn within India from their investment in government securities, these profits in turn has to be reinvested only within India, and they cannot take out these profits out of India. So accordingly, the finance minister has now stated that the NRIs may be allowed to repatriate some of the profits which they earn from government securities. Secondly, presently the foreign portfolio investors are allowed to invest in both government securities as well as the corporate bonds. However, there is a limit on the FPI investment, wherein the FPI investment limit in the government securities is 6%, whereas the FPI limit in the corporate bonds is 9%. Now, this means that, let's say, in a particular financial year, the government of India has raised total 100 rupees in the form of loans by issuing the government securities. Then the total amount of investment allowed for the FPIs is rupees 6 only. Similarly, if the total amount of money raised through the issuance of the corporate bonds is rupees 100, then the FPI cannot invest more than rupees 9 in the corporate bond market. Now, in this year's budget, the government of India has decided to increase the FPI limit in the corporate bond from 9% to 15%. Now, such an initiative has been taken by the government of India so as to strengthen the corporate bond market and to attract greater amount of foreign investment. Thirdly, as you all must be aware, recently the government of India has issued an exchange traded fund which known as the Bharat Bond ETF. Now the Bharat Bond ETF basically comprises of the bonds that are issued by the public sector undertakings. Now the issuance of Bharat Bond ETF can basically be attributed to the deepening of the bond market, and it has achieved a remarkable success. Now taking this forward, in this year's budget, the finance minister has proposed an idea to float a new debt ETF. Now, the new debt ETF would basically comprises of the government securities issued by the government of India. So, if you look at the Bharat Bond ETF, it will consist of the bonds that are issued by the public sector undertakings, whereas the new debt ETF proposed by the finance minister will comprise of the government securities issued by the central government. So this is a new proposal of the finance minister in order to strengthen or deepen the bond market. Now the next set of initiatives are related to MSME sector. Under this, the first initiative is to enable all the categories of NBFCs to extend the invoice financing to MSMEs through the TREDS platform. Now the TREDS platform here stands for Trade Receivable Electronic Discounting System. Let us understand as to what do you mean by invoice financing and how the TREDS platform actually works. Now let's say a particular MSME sells its product to a corporate buyer. For instance, a garment manufacturing MSME sells its product to a corporate buyer such as the Shopper Stop. So when the products are sold, then the corporate buyer would be issuing an invoice or a bill. Now let's consider a case where this particular invoice would be paid after a period of 1 month. However, the MSME here may be in the need of the immediate requirements of the money in order to meet its operational requirements. So what the MSME can do here is that it can sell this invoice on the TREDS platform in order to meet its immediate operational requirements. So in the TREDS platform, you would have the banks and the specific category of NBFCs which are known as the NBFC factors. So the MSME here, what it would do is that it would auction this particular invoice at a discounted price. Now let's say the MSME has got an invoice of rupees 100 which would be paid by the corporate buyer after a period of 1 month. So MSME here would try to auction this particular invoice worth rupees 100 in order to meet its operational requirements. So various participants on the trades platform would do a bidding for this particular invoice. Let's say a particular bank A would bid for this particular invoice to be bought at rupees 95. Another bank B may bid for this particular invoice at rupees 97. So here the MSME would get higher amount of money by selling this particular invoice to the bank B. So MSME would sell this invoice to bank B at rupees 97 and it would be able to meet its immediate operational requirements. So here, looking from the bank's perspective, the bank has bought this invoice worth rupees 100 at rupees 97, and after a period of 1 month, when it produces this invoice before the corporate buyer, the bank would be getting back rupees 100. So the overall profit for the bank here is rupees 3. And looking from the perspective of MSME, the MSME here has sold an invoice worth rupees 100 at rupees 97. So the loss for MSME is rupees 3. Actually, this is not a loss, but rather it is a kind of interest that the MSME has paid to the bank. So overall, if you look at the trades platform, the trades platform basically enables the micro, small and medium enterprises to auction their invoices and meet their immediate operational requirements. Now, so far, under the trades platform, we used to allow only the NBFCs that are categorized as the NBFC factors, and the other categories of NBFCs were not allowed to participate on the trades platform. Now, in this year's Union Budget, the Finance Minister has stated that even the other categories of NBFCs may be allowed to operate on the trades platform. Thus, by expanding the scope of NBFCs that can operate on the trades platform, we would be able to ensure that the micro, small and medium enterprises are able to meet their operational requirements. Nextly, the Finance Minister has announced that a new scheme shall be unveiled by the Government of India in order to provide for the subordinate debt to the entrepreneurs of the micro, small and medium enterprises. Let's understand as to what you mean by the subordinate debt. Now, when a company raises the loans, the debt of the company can be categorized into two types, that is the subordinated debt and the non-subordinated debt. So when the company fails or if it is on the verge of closure, then such a company obviously would be required to pay back the money to its borrowers. So the priority here is that first and foremost, the non-subordinated debt would be paid, and only when the money is left, the subordinated debt would be paid. So if you look at the subordinated debt is considered to be much riskier as compared to the non-subordinated debt. And because of the risk factor involved in giving the subordinated debt, the rate of interest tends to be higher. Now, in this year's Union Budget, the Finance Minister has announced that the banks in case of India would be allowed to provide for the subordinated debt to the micro, small and medium enterprises. And this subordinated debt provided by the banks shall be in the form of a quasi-equity. This means that when the banks provide for the subordinated debt to the MSMEs, then the banks can acquire certain amount of stake in the ownership of the MSMEs. So the Finance Minister has announced that a new scheme shall be unveiled by the Government of India that will enable the banks to provide the subordinated debt to the micro, small and medium enterprises. Now, coming to the next initiative, presently micro, small and medium enterprises have taken huge amount of loans from the Indian banks. However, due to their poor financial position, these MSMEs are not in a position to repay back their loans, leading to the increase in the non-performing assets of the Indian banks. In this particular regard, the Reserve Bank of India had come up with a scheme to undertake the debt restructuring of MSMEs by the Indian banks. As part of the debt restructuring, the Indian banks can reduce the principal amount, that is the loan amount to be repaid back by MSMEs, they can reduce the rate of interest, or they may extend the due date for the repayment of the loans. Now, this particular debt restructuring scheme of MSMEs was supposed to end on March 31st, 2020, and in this year's budget, the Finance Minister has stated that this particular scheme shall be extended till March 2021. Apart from that, in recent times, the Government of India has signed free trade agreements with large number of countries in order to boost its exports. There is an immense opportunity before the MSMEs to boost its export of pharmaceutical products as well as the automobile components. However, it has been found out that the micro, small and medium enterprises have failed to capitalize on such an opportunity due to poor awareness and due to the poor technology. Hence, in this particular regard, the finance minister has stated that a new scheme shall be unveiled by the government of India in order to provide for the necessary handholding support to the selected MSMEs. Now, such a scheme shall be implemented by both Exim Bank as well as SIDBI. The next initiative is related to setting up of the International Bullion Exchange. Now, presently, most of the bullion trading or the trading in terms of gold usually takes place at the international financial centers such as London, New York, Singapore, etc. So, the rate at which the gold is being traded at the International Financial Service Center, in turn, this particular rate is used to benchmark the international gold prices. So, in a way, the International Financial Service Center are able to dictate the international gold prices. However, if you look at India, India is considered to be a major importer and consumer of gold. In spite of being a major importer and consumer, we have not been able to dictate the international gold prices, whereas the International Financial Service Center are able to do so. Apart from that, the gold trading within the Indian economy remains highly fragmented. Hence, in order to address these problems related to gold trading, the finance minister has announced to set up the International Bullion Exchange. Now, this particular exchange shall be established in the International Financial Service Center located within the GIFT city, Gujarat. Now, as to how the setting up of the International Bullion Exchange would benefit the Indian economy. Now, presently, most of the gold trading is taking place at the International Financial Service Center such as London, New York, etc. So, by setting up of the International Bullion Exchange within India, we would be able to promote the onshore trading of gold. Further, this will also give a boost to the International Financial Service Center located in the GIFT city, and being a major importer and consumer of gold, we would be able to dictate the international gold prices. Now, so far, we have discussed about the first pillar of support, that is a clean and sound financial sector. Now, coming to the second pillar of support, that is the governance. Under the governance, the first initiative of the finance minister is related to the introduction of the taxpayer's charter under the IT Act. Now, you all must have heard about the citizen's charter. The citizen's charter is basically a document that is put forth by a government agency that has a large public interface. The citizen's charter enunciates the mandate of the government agency. It lists the services provided by the government agency. It highlights as to what quality of services shall be provided by the government agency and what should a citizen do if a citizen is not happy with the quality of services provided by a government agency. Such a citizen's charter improves the trust between the citizens and government agencies. It improves the service delivery by the government agencies. More importantly, the citizen's charter is considered to be an important tool to promote good governance. Similar to citizen's charter, some of the countries such as USA, Canada and Australia, these countries have adopted the taxpayer's charter. The taxpayer's charter basically enunciates as to what would be the rights of the taxpayers and what would be their obligations. With respect to rights of the taxpayers, the rights of the taxpayer can include the right to be treated with respect by the tax administration, right to be treated with fairness and impartiality, and right not to be harassed by the income tax officials. The obligations of the taxpayers could be to remain honest, to maintain tax records while filing the IT returns, and to cooperate with the tax officials. So, in a way, the taxpayer's charter is considered to be essential in order to improve the trust between the tax officers and the taxpayers, and it also prevents the undue harassment of the taxpayers. So, in this year's budget, the finance minister has proposed that the taxpayer's charter shall be included under the IT Act itself. So, this is considered to be one of the major initiatives of the government in order to improve the tax administration. The second initiative is related to recruitment to non-gazetted post. Presently, in case of India, multiple agencies conduct examination for conducting the recruitment to the non-gazetted post, because of which it imposes a substantial amount of burden on our younger population. In order to address this particular problem, the finance minister has proposed to set up the National Recruitment Agency. Now, this particular agency shall conduct a computer-based online common eligibility test. The finance minister has also announced that test centers shall be set up in each and every district of India, particularly in the aspirational districts. The next initiative is related to the unveiling of the National Policy on Official Statistics. Now, in recent times, a number of economists have raised concerns over the reliability of GDP estimates. For instance, the former chief economic advisor Mr. Arvind Subramaniam has highlighted that we may be overestimating our GDP by at least 2.5 to 3%. Apart from that, in recent times, rapid advancements have taken place in the field of technology, such as the artificial intelligence, big data, and so on. However, the official statistical machinery has failed to capitalize on this particular opportunity in order to come up with reliable and foolproof estimates of various macroeconomic indicators. Accordingly, in this year's budget, the finance minister has proposed to unveil the National Policy on Official Statistics. Such a policy would focus on adoption of latest technology such as the artificial intelligence, big data, and so on, and it would also address questions related to the reliability of the GDP estimates. Now, coming to our discussion on the next section related to taxation proposals, let us understand as to what changes have been introduced for the income tax. Now, presently, there are around 100 tax exemptions that are provided under the IT Act. These exemptions are provided under Section 80C and Section 80D and basically include the investment made under Public Provident Fund, National Pension Scheme, Health Insurance, Mutual Funds, and so on. So, since we are provided for large number of exemptions under the IT Act, it in turn has caused a number of problems. For instance, it has led to a complicated tax regime in the Indian economy, and it has also increased the dependence of the taxpayers on the professionals in order to file the income tax returns. It is against this particular backdrop, the Finance Minister of India has announced for an optional tax regime. Now, we call this as an optional tax regime because even now, the taxpayers would have an option whether they want to move to the new tax regime or not. Under the new tax regime, the taxpayers would not be able to avail any tax exemption. However, if the taxpayers stick to the old tax regime, they will continue to avail the tax exemptions. However, if you compare the new tax rates with the old tax rates, the new tax regime would have lesser amount of tax rates. For instance, if you look at this particular table here, for those people whose annual income is between 0 to 5 lakhs, for these categories of people, the tax rates have remained unchanged. However, earlier, for those people whose annual income was between 5 to 10 lakhs, these people were required to pay 20% income tax. Now, the earlier tax slab has now got divided into two tax slabs. The first tax slab is between 5 to 7.5 lakh and the second tax slab is between 7.5 to 10 lakh. With respect to first tax slab, now the tax rate is 10% and for the second tax slab, the tax rate is now 15%. So, if you compare the new tax rates with the old tax rates under the new tax regime, the taxpayers would be liable to pay 5% less amount of tax. Similarly, under the older tax regime, for those people whose annual income was greater than 10 lakh, these people were required to pay 30% income tax. However, this particular tax slab has now got divided into multiple slabs. For those people whose annual income is between 10 to 12.5 lakh, these people would be required to pay 20%. For the people whose annual income is between 12.5 to 15 lakh, they would be required to pay 25%. And for those people whose annual income is greater than 15 lakh, they will continue to pay the older tax rate of 30%. So overall, now the people of India would have an option to either pay the tax according to the older tax regime or they can pay the tax according to the new tax regime. However, if they are paying tax according to the older tax regime, then they would be able to avail the tax exemptions. However, if they pay tax according to a new tax regime, they will not be able to avail any kind of tax exemptions. The finance minister has stated that the new optional tax regime has basically been introduced in order to simplify the tax structure and reduce the dependence of the taxpayers on the professional to file the IT returns. Let us now understand as to how the new optional tax regime would have an impact on the Indian economy. First and foremost, under the new optional tax regime, the income tax rates have got substantially reduced, which means to say now the people of India would be required to pay less amount of tax to the Indian government, because of which their disposable income as such would increase. So the higher disposable income of the people would in turn convert into increase in the consumption expenditure. Now the increase in the consumption expenditure is considered to be quite critical, because it is a consumption expenditure that contributes almost up to 60% of India's GDP, and it is considered to be a major driver. However, in recent times, there has been decline in the consumption expenditure leading to the present economic slowdown. Hence, it is expected that the new optional tax regime would boost the consumption expenditure and put the Indian economy on the higher GDP growth rates. The other benefits include reduced tax rates, simplification of the tax regime, and it reduces the dependence of the taxpayers on the professionals to file the income tax. Now, in spite of these benefits associated with the optional tax regime, the optional tax regime has number of problems and concerns. Now, some of the experts have pointed out that the new optional tax regime may actually end up adversely impacting the savings and investment rate within the Indian economy. Let us understand as to how the optional tax regime has an impact on savings and investment rate. Now, if you look at the old tax regime, under the old tax regime, some of the people used to deliberately make an investment in various tax saving instruments. These tax saving instruments could be national savings certificate, public provident fund, investment in mutual funds, investment in health insurance, and so on. So people used to make investment in these tax saving instruments basically to reduce their tax liability and pay less amount of tax to the Indian government. Apart from that, the people's investment in tax saving instruments also benefited the Indian economy. This is so because when people used to make investment in national saving certificate, public provident fund, mutual funds, and so on, this in turn led to increase in household savings and investment. However, under the new tax regime, the taxpayers are not allowed to avail any kind of tax exemption for making investment in tax saving instruments. So some of the experts have pointed out that doing away with the tax exemptions may actually discourage the people from saving and investing, leading to an overall decline in savings and investment rate. So the experts have pointed out that if more number of people adopt the new tax regime, then this may have an adverse impact on the savings and investment rate of the Indian economy. Now this becomes important because the Economic Survey 2018-19 had talked about the virtuous economic cycle that was adopted by China. So what China had basically done was that it mobilized the savings of the people into the investment. These investments were in turn used to boost its exports and employment, leading to increase in the income levels of the people. So the higher income levels of the people in turn translated into higher savings, leading to a virtuous economic cycle in case of China. Accordingly, the economic survey had also highlighted that India should adopt such an investment and savings driven model. But as stated before, if more number of people move to the new tax regime, then this may have an adverse impact on savings and investment rates of the households, and this can make it difficult for India to have such a virtuous economic cycle. Now, this is the first reason as to how the new optional tax regime may have an adverse impact on the Indian economy. Secondly, the present economic slowdown faced by the Indian economy is on account of both cyclical and structural factors. The structural factors that have contributed to the present economic slowdown basically include the decline in savings and investment rates within the Indian economy. For instance, the savings rates have got reduced from almost 36% of India's GDP to 29% of India's GDP presently. Similarly, there has been a secular decline in the investment rates of the Indian economy. So overall, it is the decline in the investment and savings rates of the Indian economy that have contributed to the present economic slowdown. Hence, in order to counter the present economic slowdown, we would have to enhance the overall savings and investment rate. In that particular regard, the new optional tax regime may actually end up adversely impacting the savings and investment rates. The second problem with respect to optional tax regime is that since the optional tax regime provides for a lower income tax rates, the government of India would end up losing almost up to 40,000 crores. Thirdly, if you compare the old tax regime with the new tax regime, you can see here that the number of tax slabs have got increased in the new tax regime. So some of the experts have pointed out that the increase in the number of tax slabs may lead to tax evasion in future. Fourthly, some of the experts have pointed out that the introduction of the new optional tax regime would create more confusion among the taxpayers. This is so because now the taxpayers would have to calculate their income tax liability under both older tax regime as well as the new tax regime. Under the older tax regime, they would have to calculate the income tax liability by taking into account various tax exemptions, and under the new tax regime, they would be required to calculate their tax liability without taking into account any tax exemptions. So going forward, the taxpayers within India would calculate the tax liability both under the old tax regime and the new tax regime and pay whichever is lower. And for doing such calculations, the taxpayers would have to take the help of professionals. So the overall idea behind the introduction of the new tax regime, as stated by the finance minister, was to simplify the tax structure. However, the experts have pointed out that the new optional tax regime would create confusion among the taxpayers as to whether they have to pay the tax under the new tax regime or the old tax regime, and for which the taxpayers would depend upon the professionals for filing the IT returns. Now coming to the next taxation proposal related to the abolition of dividend distribution tax. Let us understand as to what exactly is dividend distribution tax and why it was abolished by the finance minister. Now in case of India, whenever the companies earn the profits, on these profits the company is required to pay the corporate tax. After paying the corporate tax, some of the companies give away certain amount of profits in the form of dividend to its shareholders. So when a company declares dividend to its shareholders, even then a company is required to pay the dividend distribution tax. Now presently the dividend distribution tax is around 15%, and if you add both surcharge as well as cess, it would come down to almost up to 20%. Now for example, a particular company has declared dividend worth rupees 100 to be given to its shareholder, then the company would be required to pay 20%, that is rupees 20, in the form of dividend distribution tax to the union government. Apart from that, if a particular shareholder of a company receives more than rupees 10 lakh as dividend in a financial year, then such a shareholder would be required to pay 10% of the dividend as a tax. So let's understand as to what is the problem with the dividend distribution tax. First and foremost, if you look at the profits earned by the company, on these profits, the company is already paying the corporate tax, and when it declares a dividend from these earned profits, the company is required to pay the dividend distribution tax. So in a way, a company is imposed double taxes on its declared profits. First and foremost, it is paying the corporate tax, and secondly, when it declares a dividend, it is ending up paying the dividend distribution tax. Secondly, some of the shareholders of the company here could be foreign investors, and these foreign investors may receive more than 10 lakh rupees in the form of dividend. Now these foreign investors were not getting the credit on the payment of dividend distribution tax within India, which means to say, let's say a particular foreign investor has already paid rupees 1000 in the form of dividend distribution tax to the Indian government, then he should not be made to pay this particular tax in his own home country. However, some of the foreign investors were paying this tax not only to the Indian government, but they are also paying in their own home country as well. So because of these problems associated with the dividend distribution tax, the finance minister of India has now decided to end the dividend distribution tax. So because of these problems, the finance minister has decided to do away with the dividend distribution tax. So going forward, whenever the shareholder gets a dividend from a company, whatever dividend that he gets, these dividends shall be added up to his annual income, and based upon the prevailing tax rate, such a shareholder would pay the income tax. So earlier we used to have a separate dividend distribution tax that was paid by the company, but now the dividend distribution tax has been abolished, and if a shareholder receives a dividend from a company, the entire dividend amount would be added up to his annual income and he would end up paying the income tax according to the tax rates. The next initiative is related to the concessional tax rate for the electricity generation companies. Recently in September 2019, the Union government decided to reduce the corporate tax rates in order to boost the investment rates within the Indian economy. Earlier, the domestic companies with annual turnover less than 400 crores, these companies were required to pay 25% of corporate tax, but now they are required to pay only 22%. Similarly, earlier, the domestic companies with annual turnover greater than 400 crores, these companies were required to pay 30% as corporate tax, but now under the new tax regime, the corporate tax rate applicable to them is 22%. Apart from these two changes in the corporate tax rates, in order to give a boost to Make in India campaign, the government of India decided to reduce the corporate tax rates for the new manufacturing companies, wherein the new manufacturing companies would be required to pay only 15% as a corporate tax rate. However, the condition to away the lower tax rates is that these new manufacturing companies should start manufacturing before March 31st, 2023. Now, in this year's budget, the finance minister has stated that the concession which we are giving to the new manufacturing companies, this particular concession in the corporate tax rate shall also be given for the new electricity generation companies. Such a tax concession has been given in order to boost the power sector of the Indian economy. So going forward, the new electricity generation companies would pay only 15% as corporate tax. The next initiative is related to tax concession for sovereign wealth fund. Now, some of the countries across the world have built huge amount of forex reserves. Now, what these countries have basically done is that they have taken out some amount of funds from the forex reserves in order to create a sovereign wealth fund. For instance, the Norwegian government operates one of the world's largest sovereign wealth fund known as the government pension fund. Similarly, China operates a sovereign wealth fund known as the Chinese Investment Corporation. Now, what these countries typically do is that these sovereign wealth funds, they normally make an investment in other countries in order to get higher returns. Now, these investments made by the sovereign wealth fund can be in capital market, it can be in infrastructure financing and so on. Now, the Indian government has set a vision to have a $5 trillion economy by the end of 2024-25. Hence, in pursuance of such an objective and to attract greater amount of sovereign wealth fund, in this year's budget, the finance minister has announced for a tax concession for the sovereign wealth funds. As part of the tax concession, the finance minister has announced for 100% tax exemptions for the sovereign wealth funds investing in the Indian economy. The next taxation proposal is related to the relaxation in the payment of tax when an employee exercises the employee stock option plan. Let us understand as to what do you mean by the employee stock option plan. As the name suggests, the employee stock option plan basically means that a company is giving an option to its employee to buy its shares. Usually, under the employee stock option plan, the employee of a company buys a share of a company at a rate which is much below the market value. For instance, if the market value of a share is rupees 10, under the employee stock option plan, the employee of a company may buy this particular share at rupees 8. Now, such an employee stock option plan is normally used by the startups which cannot afford to pay higher salaries or compensation package to its employees. So, instead of paying higher salaries or compensation to its employees, the startups offer the employees to buy its shares at a rate which is much below the market rates. Now, under the present taxation regime, the employee of a company is required to pay the tax when he exercises the employee stock option plan, that is, when an employee buys the shares of a company at a rate that is much below the market rate, then the employee is required to pay the tax. And the tax amount is basically calculated on the difference between the market value of the share and the price at which he buys the share. Apart from paying the tax at the time of buying of the share, the employee is also required to pay the tax when he sells the share. So when an employee sells the share, then he would be required to pay the capital gains tax. Now, as per the budget proposal, certain amount of relaxation has been given to the employee on exercising the employee stock option plan. That is, certain relaxation has been given to the employee when he buys the shares of a company. The relaxation here is that the employee of a company is required to pay the tax after 5 years. He can pay the tax when he leaves the company, or he can pay the tax when he sells the share. So whichever is earliest among all of these three, that time the employee of a company would be required to pay the tax on exercising the employee stock option plan. So as far as your prelims is concerned, you should know as to what exactly is employee stock option plan and what is the present taxation with respect to exercising of the employee stock option plan. The next taxation proposal is related to a launch of a new scheme known as Vivad Se Vishwas. Now recently the government of India had launched a scheme known as Sabka Vishwas scheme. Now this particular scheme has basically been launched by the government of India in order to reduce the litigation in the indirect taxes. On similar lines, presently there are a number of litigation cases before the courts with respect to payment of direct taxes. Hence, in order to reduce the litigation cases in the direct taxes, the government of India is set to introduce a new scheme known as Vivad Se Vishwas. Now, this particular scheme, that is Vivad Se Vishwas, is similar to Sabka Vishwas scheme, which is for the indirect taxes. Under the Vivad Se Vishwas scheme, the taxpayer would be required to pay only the disputed tax amount, and whatever interest and penalty which is required to be paid, that interest and penalty would be completely waived off by the union government. The next taxation proposal is related to the imposition of health cess. Presently, India has become one of the major manufacturer and exporter of medical equipment. So going forward, there is a need to give push to the domestic manufacturing of the medical equipment and reduce the imports of the medical equipment. So in this regard, the budget has proposed to impose the health cess on the imports of the medical equipment. Now the imposition of health cess would benefit Indian economy in mainly two ways. First and foremost, it will protect our domestic industry, and whatever money that we would collect under the health cess, this particular money, we can use it to fund our healthcare expenditure. The next taxation proposal is related to increase in the national calamity contingency duty. Now presently we are imposing additional excise duty on certain harmful goods such as cigarettes, bidis, etc. This additional excise duty is known as National Calamity Contingency Duty. So whatever money that we collect under the National Calamity Contingency Duty is in turn used for funding the National Disaster Response Fund. In this year's budget, the Finance Minister has proposed to increase the National Calamity Contingency Duty on the manufacture of cigarettes. Now coming to our next section of budget at a glance, wherein we shall be discussing the trends in the important macroeconomic indicators. Now for the upcoming financial year 2020-2021, the government of India has estimated the revenue receipts at 20 lakh crore, and it has estimated the capital receipts to be at around 10 lakh crore. So let us understand as to from which all sources the government is going to get the receipts and where the government is going to spend this particular money. So as you can see here, the total receipts of the government for the upcoming financial year is estimated to be at around 30 lakh crore. And out of this 30 lakh crore, almost 20% of the money would be raised by the government of India through the borrowings and other liabilities. And as you must be aware, the borrowings and other liabilities are part of the capital receipts. Similarly, the non-debt capital receipts of the government of India is estimated to be at around 6%. The other sources of receipts of the government are basically the revenue receipts, and among the revenue receipts here, we can see the largest share is being contributed by both corporate tax as well as GST, wherein both corporate tax and GST contribute almost up to 18% of the government's revenue. The next major share of tax revenue is contributed by income tax, followed by union excise duty and customs duty. Whereas the overall contribution of the non-tax revenue stands at around 10%. With respect to your prelims, please note that among the direct taxes, the maximum contribution is done by corporate tax followed by the income tax, and among the indirect taxes, the highest contribution is by GST. So out of 30 lakh crore estimated as receipt for the government of India, almost 1/4 or rather 20% of the government's receipts would be through borrowings and other liabilities, 18% in the form of corporate tax, 18% in the form of GST, followed by other kinds of taxes. Now the question is, where is the government of India going to spend this 30 lakh crores in the upcoming financial year? Out of this 30 lakh crore, almost up to 20% would be transferred to the states in the form of their share of taxes. Further, as you all must be aware, interest payments, defense, subsidies and pensions are part of revenue expenditure. And among these components of revenue expenditure, the highest share is that of interest payment, which stands at almost up to 18% of the overall government's expenditure. The government of India provides funding to two types of schemes, that is centrally sponsored schemes and central sector schemes. With respect to central sector schemes, these are the schemes that are entirely funded by the union government. More importantly, these schemes are directly implemented by the center. However, with respect to centrally sponsored schemes, the centrally sponsored schemes are funded by both center and state in a particular ratio, and these centrally sponsored schemes are actually implemented by the state government. So with respect to funding for central sector schemes and the funding for the centrally sponsored schemes, as you can see here, the overall funding for the central sector schemes at 13% is higher than the funding for the centrally sponsored schemes at 9%. Now with respect to your prelims, please note that among the different components of revenue expenditure, the highest share is that of the interest payment. Now coming to the trends in the tax receipts, according to annual financial statement, the government has stated that the overall gross tax revenue of the government for the financial year 2019-20 stands at around 21 lakh crore. That means the tax to GDP ratio is around 10.6%. And for the upcoming financial year, that is 2020-21, the overall gross tax revenue would increase to 24 lakh crore. That means the tax to GDP ratio would increase from 10.6 to 10.8%. So if you look at the overall increase in the gross tax revenue according to government, the government expects that the gross tax revenue would increase by 12%. And according to government, the nominal GDP growth rate is expected to increase by 10% in the upcoming financial year. So if you look at the tax buoyancy of the Indian economy, that highlights the increase in the tax revenue for every 1% increase in the nominal GDP growth rate. Now the tax buoyancy is calculated as increase in the tax revenue divided by the increase in the GDP growth rate. So the government of India expects that the gross tax revenue would increase by 12% and the nominal GDP growth rate would increase by 10%. So accordingly, the government of India expects a tax buoyancy of 1.2. Now the tax buoyancy which the government expects for the upcoming financial year is much higher than the tax buoyancy in the present financial year, wherein for the present financial year, the tax buoyancy was only around 0.5. Now in this year's budget, the government of India has abolished the dividend distribution tax. It has also reduced the income tax rates, because of which some of the experts have pointed out that the government may find it difficult to have a tax buoyancy rate of 1.2. Further, if you look at the trends in the tax receipts, the tax to GDP ratio started increasing from 10.6 in the year 2015-16 to 11.2 in the year 2017-18. However, since the year 2017-18, the tax to GDP ratio has been declining as shown in this particular graph. Now in the second part of the graph here, you have the share of direct taxes and the share of indirect taxes, and as you can see here, the share of the direct taxes is much higher than the share of indirect taxes. Now let us look at the trends in the various deficits such as the fiscal deficit, revenue deficit and so on. But before that, let us understand certain basic details about the FRBM Act. Under the FRBM Act, the government of India is required to reduce the fiscal deficit to 3% of India's GDP by the end of 2021. Apart from that, the government of India is required to reduce the general debt level to below 60%. That means the debt of both central government as well as the state government should reduce to below 60%. And the central government debt has to reduce to below 40% of India's GDP by the end of 2024-25. And in order to pursue the reduction in the fiscal deficit and the government debt, the government of India is required to prescribe the annual targets for the reduction. However, certain amount of flexibility has been given to government of India in the form of escape clause. Now, under the escape clause, the government of India can increase the fiscal deficit by 0.5% on account of some reasons. Now, these reasons could be related to national security, war, collapse of agriculture, bringing in structural reforms, or a general decline in the GDP growth rate within the Indian economy. Now, in pursuance with the FRBM Act, earlier, the government of India had targeted to reduce the fiscal deficit for the financial year 2019-20 to 3.3% of India's GDP. And similarly, it had targeted to reduce the fiscal deficit for the year 2020 to 3% of India's GDP. However, since the Indian economy is presently facing the slowdown, and since the government of India is required to bring in the structural reforms in order to boost India's GDP growth rate, the government of India has used the escape clause under the FRBM Act. Accordingly, the fiscal deficit targets have been revised to account for an increase of 0.5%. So, according to revised target, the fiscal deficit for the year 2019-20 stands at 0.5% higher at 3.8%. And the fiscal deficit target for the upcoming financial year stands at 0.5% higher at 3.5%. So, as compared to the previous targets now, the targets for the fiscal deficit have increased by 0.5% mainly on account of the government exercising the escape clause. Secondly, as you all must be aware, the fiscal deficit of the government of India basically represents the overall borrowings of the government in a financial year. So, this particular borrowed money the government uses for both revenue expenditure as well as the capital expenditure. Ideally, the borrowed money should be used for financing capital expenditure rather than meeting the revenue expenditure. If you are using the fiscal deficit more for financing the revenue expenditure, it would mean that there is a decline in the quality of fiscal deficit. Now, presently, one of the biggest problems of the Indian economy is that more amount of fiscal deficit is presently used for financing the revenue expenditure. For instance, in the last financial year, the government of India borrowed almost 7.6 lakh crore, and out of this 7.6 lakh crore, almost up to 5 lakh crore was spent on revenue expenditure. Now, in this year's budget, since the Indian economy is presently facing the economic slowdown, we should have increased our capital expenditure and reduced the revenue expenditure. However, as per the government estimates, the revenue deficit is set to increase. As you can see here, the revenue deficit is set to increase from 2.4% to 2.7% of India's GDP, because of which the share of revenue expenditure in fiscal deficit would increase from 63% in the year 2019-20 to 77% in the upcoming financial year. So, overall, some of the experts have pointed out that there has been a decline in the quality of fiscal deficit of India. Now, according to Government of India, the fiscal deficit for the financial year 2019-20 stands at around 7.6 lakh crore. And the fiscal deficit for the upcoming financial year would increase to almost around 8 lakh crore. Hence, let us try to understand as to what are the various sources of deficit financing. That is, from what all sources the government has been borrowing the money. Now, the market borrowings of the government of India has been highlighted through this particular line, and the numbers have been highlighted on the right hand side of this particular graph. The other sources of financing fiscal deficit excluding the market borrowings have been highlighted here, and the actual numbers have been highlighted on the left hand side of this particular graph. And as you can see here, for the financial year 2019-20, the major source for the government borrowing or financing the fiscal deficit was a market borrowing, which was almost around 5 lakh crore. The second major source for financing fiscal deficit was the securities against the small savings, which stood at almost around 2.5 lakh crores. So, the two major sources of financing fiscal deficit are market borrowings and securities against the small savings. Let us understand as to what do you mean by the securities against the small savings. Now, presently the government of India is implementing a number of small saving schemes for the benefit of poor and vulnerable sections. Some of these small saving schemes are post office deposits, national savings certificate, public provident fund, Kisan Vikas Patra and so on. So whatever money the government collects under the small saving schemes, all that money goes into a separate fund known as the National Small Savings Fund. Now the money under the National Small Savings Funds is in turn invested in special government securities and it is considered to be the government's borrowings. So apart from borrowing from the market, the second major source for financing fiscal deficit is the securities that the government has been issuing against the small savings schemes. Now coming to the last part of our discussion, wherein we shall be discussing about the various positives and negatives with respect to union budget. Now with respect to positives about the union budget, before the presentation of the budget, there was a general decline in India's GDP growth rate on account of both cyclical and structural factors which required the finance minister to provide the fiscal stimulus. As part of fiscal stimulus, the finance minister was required to enhance the government's expenditure and reduce the tax rates in order to boost the declining consumption expenditure. However, doing so would mean that the government of India would be required to breach the fiscal deficit target that it has set under the FRBM Act. Now, under the FRBM Act, the government of India was required to reduce the fiscal deficit to 3.3% of India's GDP for the financial year 2019-20, and for the next financial year, it was required to reduce the fiscal deficit to 3%. So the biggest dilemma before the finance minister was whether we should stick to fiscal stimulus and do away with the FRBM Act, or should we stick to the FRBM Act and do away with the fiscal stimulus. Now in this year's budget, the finance minister has done a fine balancing between these two contrasting objectives. While in order to ensure that the government does not breach the target set under the FRBM Act, the finance minister has used the escape clause in order to increase the fiscal deficit by 0.5%, and at the same time we have been able to provide the fiscal stimulus as well. More importantly, it is to be noted that we have been able to provide the fiscal stimulus even when there has been a decline in the tax revenue. For instance, the overall increase in the capital expenditure is about 18%, and this is considered to be quite notable, particularly when the tax revenue has been declining. Similarly, in order to boost the consumption expenditure and to ensure more disposable income in the hands of people, we have reduced the tax rates and we have also abolished the dividend distribution tax. So overall, this year's union budget was a kind of fine balancing between two contrasting objectives, wherein we were able to provide the fiscal stimulus without violating the fiscal deficit target under the FRBM Act. The other positives about the union budget can be seen with respect to agriculture sector, wherein the finance minister has unveiled 16 action plans with a predominant focus so as to improve the agriculture marketing infrastructure. Some of the notable initiatives for the agriculture sector include the launch of Krishi Rail, Krishi Udan, integration of the negotiable warehousing receipts with the ENAM, etc. The second positive about the union budget can be seen with respect to industry and investment, particularly with respect to integration of Assemble India with the Make in India. Apart from that, the launch of Nirvik scheme so as to boost India's exports is another notable initiative of the union budget. With respect to the initiative of the Indian Railways, the notable initiatives here include attracting more amount of private sector investment in the Indian Railways, similar to the way we have been able to attract the private sector investment in the road infrastructure. The notable initiatives here include launch of new Tejas Express, attracting more public-private partnership in the development of stations, enabling the Indian Railways to set up the solar plants along the railway tracks to meet their energy needs and so on. With respect to taxation proposals, as discussed before, the reduction in the income tax rate would undoubtedly give boost to the increase in the consumption expenditure. The abolition of dividend distribution tax would benefit the corporate entities and promote greater amount of investment. The introduction of taxpayers' charters as introduced in other countries is a great initiative that can promote greater level of transparency in the tax administration. The launch of Vivad Se Vishwas scheme is set to reduce the tax litigation and improve the tax collection by the government of India. So overall, the taxation proposals introduced in this particular budget are in the right direction. Some of the good initiatives in the financial sector include increase in the deposit insurance coverage of the banks, the various steps that the government has taken in order to strengthen the bond market. The setting up of the international bullion exchange in the GIFT City is another notable initiative taken in the union budget. Now, coming to various concerns that have been raised with respect to union budget, the first concern is with respect to decline in the quality of fiscal deficit. Now, in this year's budget, the finance minister has used the escape clause under the FRBM Act in order to increase the fiscal deficit by 0.5%. Now, this indeed is a good move by the finance minister in order to boost the consumption expenditure and put India's economy on the higher GDP growth track. However, whatever money that we are borrowing, that is a fiscal deficit, ideally we should use it for the capital expenditure and not for the revenue expenditure. But in the financial year 2019-20, almost 63% of the fiscal deficit, that is almost 63% of our borrowings, we use it for financing the revenue expenditure. And in the next financial year, we are going to increase this particular share to 77%. That means going forward, more amount of our borrowings are going to be used for funding the revenue expenditure and not for funding the capital expenditure. So overall, some of the experts have pointed out that there has been decline in the quality of fiscal deficit due to the increase in the share of the revenue expenditure in our fiscal deficit. So the question here is, what should be done in order to address this particular problem? That is, what should be done in order to ensure that whatever money that we are borrowing, that is a fiscal deficit, we should use it only for the capital expenditure and not for the revenue expenditure. Now, this was originally done under the FRBM Act. Now, under the FRBM Act earlier, we used to target both fiscal deficit and the revenue deficit. Under the original FRBM Act, the fiscal deficit was targeted to reduce to 3% of India's GDP and the revenue deficit was targeted to reduce to 0% of India's GDP. The idea behind the original FRBM Act was to ensure that the entire government's borrowing is used for financing the capital expenditure and not for financing the revenue expenditure. However, the original FRBM Act has now been amended and we have done away with the targeting of the revenue deficit, and instead of targeting the revenue deficit, now we are targeting the government debt apart from targeting the fiscal deficit. So, because of the new amendments that have been introduced under the FRBM Act, there has been a general decline in the quality of fiscal deficit. So, some of the experts have pointed out that now we need to amend this particular FRBM Act and we have to reincorporate the targeting of revenue deficit once again. Doing so would enhance the quality of fiscal deficit. The next concerns have been raised with respect to the changes in the new tax regime. As stated before, some of the experts have pointed out that the adoption of the new tax regime may have an adverse impact on the savings rates of the households. Apart from that, the introduction of the new tax regime along with the existence of the older tax regime may lead to confusion among the taxpayers, which in turn would increase their dependence on the professionals to file the income tax. The next concern is related to nature of spending. Since the Indian economy is facing the slowdown primarily on account of decline in the consumption expenditure, it was expected that the government of India would allocate more amount of money for various schemes such as MG Narega, PM Kisan scheme and so on, in order to boost the employment opportunities and enhance the consumption expenditure. However, there has been decrease in the allocation under the MG Narega scheme. For the financial year 2019-20, we had spent almost up to 71,000 crore for the MG Narega. But for the upcoming financial year, we have allocated only up to 61,500 crores, which means that there has been decline in the total amount of money allocated for the MG Narega. Similarly, for the PM Kisan scheme, for the financial year 2019-20, the total budgetary outlay was worth rupees 75,000 crore. However, according to government's documents, the total amount of money that we have spent under the PM Kisan for the financial year 2019-20 is hardly around 54,000 crore. So, overall, the government of India has allocated less amount of money for various schemes that have a potential to boost the employment creation and increase the consumption expenditure. Similarly, this year's budget talks about a very important theme of aspirational India in order to ensure that all the sections of Indian society are able to meet their aspirational needs. However, the amount of money that we have allocated to health and education, this allocation has increased by mere 8% and 4.5% respectively. Further, there has also been a decrease in the allocation of various schemes that are related to the welfare of scheduled caste. The next concern is related to the estimates about the tax revenue. For the next financial year, the government estimates that the tax revenue would increase by 12% and the nominal GDP growth rate would be at 10%. Accordingly, the government expects that the tax buoyancy would be at 1.2. Now, this is considered to be quite problematic because the tax buoyancy for the year 2019-20 was hardly at around 0.5. More importantly, the government may not be able to increase its tax revenue by 12% because presently the Indian economy is facing the slowdown, and because of such a slowdown, there may be a decline in the tax collection. Apart from that, the government of India has reduced the income tax rates in the new tax regime, and it has also abolished the dividend distribution tax. These two measures would obviously lead to decrease in the tax revenue by the government of India, which means that it may become difficult for the government to increase its tax revenue by 12%. The next concerns have been raised with respect to ambitious disinvestment targets set by the government of India. For the upcoming financial year, the government of India has set an ambitious target of disinvestment at 2.10 lakh crore. Now, this is considered to be problematic because in the financial year 2019-20, the government had estimated the total disinvestment target to be at around 1.05 lakh crore. However, the total amount of money that we are able to raise through disinvestment was hardly at around 65,000 crore. Because of which some of the experts have pointed out that it may become difficult for the government to meet this ambitious target of 2.10 lakh crore for the upcoming financial year. The next concerns have been raised with respect to agriculture sector. As you all must be aware, the government of India has come up with a grand vision of doubling the farmers' income. However, in order to double the farmers' income, we would require the farmers' income to increase by 15% per annum over the next 3 years. However, presently, the farmers' income in case of India is hardly increasing at 3% per annum, because of which some of the experts have pointed out that the government of India may find it difficult to double the farmers' income by the end of 2022. Apart from that, in this year's budget, the finance minister has stated that the states would be incentivized in order to adopt the various model central laws. It is to be noted that the central government has been incentivizing the states to adopt these model central laws since the year 2013. However, the response of the states has been poor so far. So the question which arises here is that how should we encourage the states to adopt the farmer-friendly agricultural policies? In this regard, the former finance minister Mr. Arun Jaitley had proposed for a federal-like body to be set up in order to bring about the reforms in the agriculture sector. Now, such a federal body would work along the lines of the GST Council. Now, in this year's budget, apart from asking the states to adopt these model central laws, we should have also proposed to set up a federal body like GST Council in order to implement various reforms in the agricultural sector. With this, we have come to the end of the analysis of the Union Budget. Thank you one and all for watching.